I will move straight into the presentation. What I basically intend to look at is the current debate going on about Boko Haram. Many of you will have heard that Boko Haram has been defeated. At least that has been the claim by some politicians, especially the president of Nigeria. So I want to exploit that and then to look at why did he make that claim? What were the factors that pushed him to make that claim? And then I will also look at you know, some of the progress that has been made in the fight against Boko Haram, and of course the challenges that we continue to face, and the way forward for us to counter the group. I put out what Buhari claimed in December last year. He actually made it the claim to BBC, in which he said Boko Haram has reverted to using improvised explosive devices, IEDs, indoctrinating young guys. They have now been reduced to that, so which means that they don't carry out the kind of traditional attacks that they are known for. And then he continues by saying that, but articulated conventional attacks on centers, communication, populations, they are no longer capable of doing that effectively. Then he also conclude by saying that, so I think technically we have won the war because people are going back into their neighborhoods. Boko Haram, as an organized fighting force, I assure you that we have dealt with them. And this is taken directly from BBC, the quote. So now this is Buhari making this claim in December, because the analysts, you know, it was a quote that the analysts criticized a lot, that I think it was too early to make such a claim, because no one in his right mind thinks that Boko Haram has been defeated. But I think one should also give some credit, you know, to President Buhari, because he was not just speaking from a vacuum. It is true. I call it actually that it was a political stunt. But, you know, as a president, you know, he must have also had some advisors, and there were some very tangible issues that forced him to make that claim. So we'll look at very quickly some of the factors that actually pushed Buhari to make this claim. Now, I think one thing to really clarify is that despite the increasing trends in attacks and death in Boko Haram between 2009 and 2015, we have witnessed some kind of a regression, you know, in the attacks and also in the death. Many of you will recall that in 2014, Boko Haram was ranked the most deadly terrorist group in the world, actually beating the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda, you know, the world's largest terrorist organization, to that, you know, because the group committed 6,644 deaths in some 662 attacks, which, of course, were well superior to what the Islamic State, which came second, committed. So it's because of this, you know, that people continue to look at Boko Haram as if that 2014 mark was going to, you know, was going to be sustained for a very long time. But if you study the group, you see that, you know, we've never really had, you know, some sort of a straight line in terms of, you know, consistent number of attacks per year. We've had some ups and downs, you know, and I think that this year cannot be the exception. But the first 5 months of 2016 have seen a remarkable drop in Boko Haram attacks. We've also seen a significant drop in number of people who died in Boko Haram attacks. This actually, before Buhari made this statement in December 2015, it was because of a 6 month period, you know, from August to December. You know, the estimate are that Boko Haram carried out or committed or, you know, perpetrated attacks that led to the death of 1,100 people. And this was the lowest that we had seen since 2013. So 2014 is when Boko Haram really reached the apex. Then we saw in 2015 some sort of a small regression. But again, data on Boko Haram in terms of its attacks and death vary with researchers. You know, people have various data on the group's attacks and the group's death, those who have died through its attacks. So I won't claim that what I provide here is universally accepted, because depending on whoever is doing the estimate. But there are some very modest estimate and some very, very generous estimate. For example, you have a conservative estimate that say between 2009 and 2015, or even 2016, that the group has carried out between 15 and 20,000 deaths. But again, if you read other sources, they put the estimate anywhere between 50,000 and 100,000. So again, the data on Boko Haram really vary with the researchers. Then let's quickly look at, I try to have a graph here to show, the trend in Boko Haram's attacks. And in order really to substantiate what Buhari claimed, and you see that 2009, we had the famous death, which is always put at 900. But again, others will claim that during July of 2009, Boko Haram and the government, the security forces, jointly committed attacks that resulted in the death of over 1,000 people. So again, no consistency, no universally accepted figures for that. And then 2010, we had that's when Abubakar Shekau returned to power, or actually took power as the leader of Boko Haram. The attacks started midway during the year, leading to about 50 attacks for that year. But the death actually was really significant, because we had about 385 deaths. And then 2011, we have 115 attacks. I think this figure was provided by Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch, which actually resulted in 550 deaths that year. And in 2012, we have 364 attacks, which resulted in 1,842 deaths. Then 2013, we have 378 attacks, which resulted in about 2,078 deaths. And 2014, 662 attacks, which resulted in 6,644. This figure is unique because it's almost universally accepted, because it was provided by the Institute of Economics and Peace, the famous Global Terrorism Index. And then 2015 is where we still have debate, because the University of Maryland has not yet released their annual figures on Boko Haram for 2015. So we have very confusing data. Some say Boko Haram carried out 540 attacks, which resulted in 6,760 deaths. And this is coming from Foreign Affairs. This is where Buhari was coming from, that we have this consistency in terms of increment, annual increment in the group's attacks. So which means the group continued to intensify its activities, which resulted in more death. And in 2016, we are seeing a significant drop. There must be a reason to this significant drop. Now, which are the factors that have been responsible for this? I think we should give some credit to the military. Boko Haram has incurred a lot of death themselves. Some estimates say, between 2015 and 2016, the military has killed between 2,000 and 7,000 Boko Haram members. Again, the data vary here. Then the military has repelled and intercepted numerous abortive attacks by Boko Haram, including suicide bombers. The famous one this year was, the incident where a vigilante personnel was able to shoot down a girl, a presumed suicide bomber, who was carrying a suicide belt, and this guy was able to identify her and then shot her down, and she died. So again, that was really heroic because first, you can't just shoot down somebody if you don't have the clear fact. And then, of course, we all territories that were formerly controlled by Boko Haram are now presumed to have been brought under the control of the government, which is another significant achievement. And I think this, in my view, probably is what has really brought the significant reduction in Boko Haram's attacks, because when they control territory, they use these territories as safe havens where they extract resources, where they have all the time to sit down, plan, and execute attacks. They use these territories to extract taxes, to actually tax people. They use these territories to for training. So these territories have also provided training bases for Boko Haram. They provide safe havens for them to build bomb factories that they have been using to manufacture household bombs that they have been using, the explosives. And then, of course, government forces backed by the multinational joint task force, which was deployed last year partially because it has not been fully deployed because of certain factors that we'll come to see. And then, of course, the military has freed majority of the hostages held by Boko Haram. I think the estimate so far put it that the military has been able to free between 2,000 and 3,000 captives. These are mostly young girls and young boys. So, I mean, it has been really an achievement. But what is still really outstanding is the fact that despite this huge liberation or rescue of these captives, the government or the forces have not been able to free the 219 remaining girls of the Chibok, the so-called Chibok girls, those who were kidnapped from the Chibok Secondary School on 14 April 2014. And I think the international community remains really, really concerned. And I think the fight against Boko Haram will not be won if these girls have not been found. The good news here is that last week there was this one girl that was liberated, out of the 219. She was alive, she had a baby. The other one was pregnant. So it shows that probably these girls are still alive, and I think it is news for us to take and then continue to fight to free the 218 that are remaining. Then another success has also been made either in neutralizing or capturing Boko Haram fighters, commanders, I would say, because they've been capturing fighters since the beginning of the campaign against Boko Haram. But this year, part of last year also, there were significant achievement in capturing Boko Haram commanders. I think this year, the capture of Khalid al-Banawi, who is the presumed leader of the splinter group Ansaru, and who is believed to be number two after Shekau, I think was a big achievement, something that we need to celebrate. And I think what is going on now with Boko Haram, because we don't see a lot of kidnappings, we'll come to see the different strategy that they are using to replace this kidnapping. Since Banawi was the kingpin, the kind of kidnapping guru for Boko Haram, we've not been able to see a lot of kidnapping since he was captured. But I think Boko Haram is also looking for his replacement. And if they get that replacement, we'll start seeing kidnapping again. And then we also have, of course, that the fact that we've not had any direct confrontation that we used to have, for example, where Boko Haram will attack security forces in a very open, direct, shootout combat. We've not had this for the past 6 months. Where it has happened, it has been very, very small and not significant, as we saw previously, particularly in 2014 and 2015. So really, again, it demonstrates that the group has been weakened and does not have the capacity that it used to have. And then what then have been the factors behind these successes? I think we can't really ignore some of the changes that Buhari brought to the Nigerian government, particularly, the fact that he gave significant priority to the issue of Boko Haram. He was able on his very first month in office to transfer the command center from Abuja to Maiduguri so that it should be closer to the battlefield and it should actually carry out more coordination. And they've been doing that. And they have reported very good coordination that they didn't used to have when the command center was far away. And then we've also have there is also the fact that he was able to address one of the issues that I thought was really bedeviling the old administration, which is the lack of morale within the army. We saw in many instances where the military were able to run away from the battle, something that was very shameful, and I think Buhari was able to address these shortcomings. And we instead, what we see today is that the military look forward to going to the battle. And I think this is a significant achievement because when they are determined, they are courageous, it means that they have confidence in themselves. And that is actually also playing out. And then there is also the use of better equipment. What we didn't have, say, in 2014, 2015, part of 2015, was, we used to rely on American drones. But if you look at what is happening now, actually Nigerian soldiers or Cameroonian soldiers are actually flying these drones themselves or controlling these drones themselves, which means they are relying on themselves for gathering of intelligence. Then there are also very sophisticated equipment, night vision equipment that many of them didn't have. They have better arms now that they didn't have before. I think in 2014, the biggest issue was that most often Nigerian soldiers used to compare themselves to Boko Haram, and then they will lament the fact that a Nigerian soldier might carry a gun that can only shoot 50 rounds. Meanwhile, he's facing a Boko Haram militant who has a very powerful gun that can fire 200 rounds. And that you can compete with a soldier of that nature. But this shortcoming has been addressed, and I think that it is now helping the military to achieve the kind of things that we are seeing. So then, of course, the other achievement in this area has been the deployment of the multinational joint task force. It has missed so many deadlines, but finally in 2015 they were able to set up the headquarters in N'Djamena and to deploy some of the element of that force. But we are still waiting for the full deployment, because the full deployment of the force will go a long way in helping the fight against Boko Haram, because what they are doing now is not providing their full capacity. Then the Boko Haram, or should we from this discussion then make that claim that Boko Haram is on the verge of collapse, or is it on the verge of being crushed by the Nigerian government or by the forces, the multinational joint task forces? I would say it is too early, to make such a very sweeping statement. And that's why Buhari was heavily criticized, not just by analysts, but also by some politicians who thought it was a very rushed decision. And I think any hasty conclusion that Boko Haram has been defeated could have devastating consequences. We know through history If you study, Boko Haram, you know that this is a group that the news about or rumors about its collapse or its death or its incapacitation is not new. You know, in 2009, for example, it was believed that Boko Haram had been obliterated, you know, when they killed the leader, the founding leader, Muhammad Yusuf, and also shot the current leader, who then was the deputy, Abubakar Shekau, and he escaped. So in Nigeria, everyone believed Boko Haram had been obliterated. But of course, Shekau came back, and many of the fighters also came back to cause more havoc. So we should not rush to any decision or any conclusion to say that Boko Haram has been defeated. We can talk of progress, yes, given some of the issues that I've highlighted. Then I also think that the group has suffered significant losses, which I already discussed, but none of this yet can be called a knockout punch, you know, to say that, yeah, because of this, the group can no longer survive. The group, which was estimated actually by one of its members that was captured last year, said the group has about 60,000 fighters. So 60,000 fighters, and then we look at what we estimate to have been the Boko Haram militant that have been killed. You see that they still have a sizable number. And some of the estimate, I think from Foreign Affairs, they even estimate that Boko Haram has between 6,000 and 9,000 fighters. So they still have a sizable force. They might not be as active as before, but the force is still sizable. I'll come to give you some of the dynamics which is making this force not to concentrate its activities in Nigeria, because Boko Haram again had to spread, you know, to the region, to Chad, Cameroon, Niger, you know, which he didn't have before, which means that, you know, the concentration of any force or the battalion for each country or the cell for each of these countries will not be as big as it used to be before. But we are not taking away the fact that they have lost a lot of fighters. Then there is also the issue, because I think in Buhari's claim, he said Boko Haram has now been reduced to suicide bombers. It is true. It is true. But suicide bombing, it's a very dangerous phenomenon. It's not something that we can take for granted, that because the group has been reduced to suicide terrorism, then it is no longer a serious threat. It is even more dangerous. So I think we need to bear that in mind. And then to wrap up the presentation so that we can really get into the questions, I want to look at the current dynamics and challenges that lie in, you know, the part of defeating Boko Haram. Since the group pledged allegiance to the Islamic State last year, in March last year, it has been undergoing some institutional transformation that we cannot deny, because for some reason it was difficult to really understand where the group was going after it pledged this allegiance, because Abubakar Shekau, the leader, almost disappeared from the limelight. You know, this was somebody who was all the time on videos or on audio audio cassette, you know, making messages or pronouncing himself on certain issues, suddenly disappeared. So I would think that for us to rush to say, as the president of Chad said it then, that he had been killed or he had been injured to the extent that he's been handicapped, I think it was very premature, because, you know, it may have been a strategy. And I think that time will have to prove us right, because Shekau had come back, especially at the point that people believed that he was dead or people believed that he was injured, to come back to say he was still strong, he was still leading the group, but did not really pronounce to tell us that his absence has been actually part of the new strategy. Because again, the group need to portray that it is really part of the Islamic State and that it is no longer Boko Haram as it used to be. Then some members of the group have gone to fight with the Islamic State in Libya, something that has really alarmed the United Nations, the Security Council, to really express this alarm last week, 2 weeks ago, when they had the summit, to say that, you know, the links between Boko Haram and Islamic State is very, very strong and very dangerous. So we should not also neglect or really ignore that factor, the fact that the alliance that they have now with the Islamic State has actually buttressed the root of the group, which means that, you know, you might have to pass through the Islamic State if you want to defeat Boko Haram. And that's a very tall order. And then we also have the fact that some Boko Haram members have infiltrated, you know, the refugee camps. You know, they've infiltrated these refugee camps. Some have lived in them and they've used them to escape, you know, to escape into cities. So some of the members are not actually living with people in the cities, which means they can still regroup and they can still carry out a lot of activities. So we can't really ignore this. The fact that some have gone abroad to fight in Libya, to fight in Syria, to fight in Iraq alongside the Islamic State, and then some have used the refugee camps to escape from the group, and also have used the refugee camps to sell drugs. So they have really exploited, you know, refugee camps for their own purpose. And then, of course, there is the point that the group has not changed its recruitment strategies. You know, it has exploited so many different strategies using social media, which is increasingly doing. But now it is selling, or it's luring youth, you know, young boys and girls towards the group by giving out airtime. You want airtime? You come, I give you airtime. Sometimes even telephones. So they are doing this, you know, to bring young people closer to the group. And I think this can be very dangerous because they are really exploiting the poverty gap in Nigeria. And I think that, you know, when it comes to the stomach, the politics of the stomach, people will always do what they need to do to survive. You know, and I think we cannot really ignore the fact that there will be some people, sometimes even the majority, that will accept this Boko Haram approaches. And then they have actually radicalized many of their children. You know, so they have kidnapped children. They themselves have made children. They develop factories for making children. And they've used these children to radicalize them into their extremism. So these children not only believe in what Boko Haram, in Boko Haram's ideology. And, you know, it's true that when you have children like this, you can be sure that the next generation of terrorism is sure. So sustainability of Boko Haram really is in place. And I think we can't just get up and say Boko Haram has been defeated, while we know that, you know, there is this next generation which is in place. Then, of course, so many other factors which I can't really explain here because of we are rushing to time. Then my last slide here is really to look at, are we at the final battle? Is this the final battle against Boko Haram? Why am I asking this question? I'm saying, yes, if we accept that we have made significant progress, many achievements have been made, some of which I've cited. But does this bring us to the point where we can say, we need to really crush Boko Haram now? Some will say yes. You know, the group has weakened, we've seen, but can we crush Boko Haram? Given some of the factors that I've mentioned, the fact that, you know, it's now with the Islamic State, it's difficult. You know, even the United Nations, you know, concur with the fact that, you know, if you want to really defeat Boko Haram, you need to pass through Libya. You know, those militants that have gone to Libya, you need to deal with them. So these are factors that we need to take into consideration. And then the military campaign needs to be buttressed by social, religious, political, economic, and developmental measures. We can't win the fight against Boko Haram through the military alone. The military has done a great job, but I think we are now at a crucial moment, which I call a crossroad, because where we are, it can either lead us to Boko Haram's resurgence or it lead us into the defeat of the group. So we need to take every measure, you know, to crush the group. And you will not crush the group just by cutting off head. You now need to deal with the fundamental issues, which are the undercutting political, economic, religious, and social issues that provoke the group. We've also, at the ISS, consistently called for criminal justice measures. You know, the fact that you need a special criminal tribunal that can be able, you know, to carry out massive investigation, you know, to prosecute, you know, what we have today in all the Lake Chad Basin countries affected by Boko Haram. The court system is really inefficient. It was not made for this kind of huge crisis, and they're finding themselves really, really difficult to deal with it. So if we are really serious about going after the key democratic principles, the key democratic pillars, which is the rule of law, we have to put in place, you know, this criminal justice measures that can actually deal with Boko Haram. Because why? It's important because there are people who have participated in Boko Haram, you know, who still think, you know, they can one day still join, you know. But if you have this investigation, it will be able to filter out some of those that, you know, you can't find with the gun. You know, the smoking gun, you won't be able to find the smoke until, you know. So it's not the same. Then I also think that such a strategy has to be very comprehensive. It has to be uncompromising. So you have various actors because the crisis itself is a multidimensional crisis. And so you can't really have just the military overpowering everywhere. It can be effective. It cannot be effective. So we need to go all out, you know, in the fight against Boko Haram, bring in all those who are relevant. And I think we need to empower some actors that we have now seen that they are efficient, such as the vigilante groups, the community initiatives that have proved very efficient, particularly in sharing intelligence, particularly in leading military operations. You know, and then also taking their own initiatives, because these people, by the way, they live with these terrorists, they know them, they sometimes know their parents, so they can really use strategies that, you know, government might not have anticipated. So we need to empower these community initiatives, community mechanisms. And then the second regional summit, which you know, was held on the 14th of May, you know, which of course followed the first one that was held in Paris in 2014. What it actually did was really to take note of, you know, the various achievements that the forces of the region, or let's say the multinational joint task force, the regional forces or the national forces have achieved in the fight against Boko Haram, which it is true, but we've always cautioned them, don't over-exaggerate. You know, there was the tendency to use the summit to sing, you know, praises, you know, for the military. I think it is still too early. We can't be singing praises now to any military. We can recognize, we can take note of the progress that has been made. It also rightly noted the road to defeating Boko Haram that it passes through Libya. So I think this was an important acknowledgement to say that you need now to tackle the issue of Libya head on, because anything less, you know, you'll still be neglecting an important part of the fight against Boko Haram. And then it was also confirmed at the summit that Boko Haram was not just a Nigerian issue, because that was the tendency, even by the international community, to assume that Boko Haram was a Nigerian issue. No, it is a regional issue. It's a Lake Chad Basin issue. The main resolution of the summit was then to strengthen regional cooperation, particularly in areas of intelligence, mutual legal assistance, and border control, and to assert, so the leaders accepted to assert their authorities on the whole of their countries. Because what has been the tradition in many African countries, if not all, has been that we've had a lot of ungoverned spaces, porous borders, many remote areas, rural areas, which had never been part of the national security apparatus. Now, the call was that we need to now take note of this place. We need to now integrate them into our national security strategies. And I think that was an important recognition. Then there was also a strong understanding of the need, you know, for cooperation with external partners. Of course, there is nothing that can happen in Africa without external partners. Because when we say external partners, we are actually talking about the purse. So you can have all your initiatives, you can have all your mechanisms, but if you don't have the finances, you are doomed. And that's why the multinational joint task force has still not been able to be fully deployed, because it was estimated that, or it was budgeted to have $700 million. But you know what it has now is not even up to one third of that. What has been pledged might be one third, but what has actually been given is far less. So we need resources. We need resources, a lot of resources, in order for this multinational joint task force to actually operate. I will make it stop here.